and welcome to Get Coached, a six-part series designed to help you prepare for and race Standard Chartered Singapore Marathon. Hello, and welcome to episode 2 of Get Coached. I'm your host, Ben Pullum from Coached, and today we're going to be talking about nutrition and fueling. I'm joined today, because I'm not an expert in nutrition and fueling, by Coral Laurent. She's a nutritionist who's spent many years living in Singapore and is now based in Portugal. Coral, welcome to the show.
Hi, Ben. Thank you for having me. Well, hi, everyone. I'm Coral, so I'm a nutritionist, and I often work with coach on supporting athletes with their nutrition for racing or even for day-to-day.
My coach always used to tell me, Coral, that you don't put diesel in a Ferrari. And when I was doing as much training as I was during my pro days, I didn't really take that to heart. I thought because I was skinny and lean, I could eat whatever I want and I'd get away with it. What I didn't understand at the time was how inflammatory it was, how it impacted my recovery, and how it probably aged me many years. I suspect if I was eating like I do now, back in my 20s, I would look a little younger now and probably have a little bit more pep in my step. For my first question, can you please talk to us about what runners should eat daily to fuel their training and recovery while keeping their immune system strong?
Yes, thank you, Ben. And don't worry, there was a lot of things we didn't really know at the time, but it's never too late to learn and correct that for the future. So that's all good. Yes, of course. And in regards to the nutrition, I always suggest athletes to focus, but first and more importantly, on the three macros that are present and they're essential to your daily nutrition. So your protein, your carbs, and your fat. And they are will be adjusted to your personal needs. And if you're working with a nutritionist, they would advise you in terms of how much you should have for your personal needs and goals. But really importantly as well is don't forget your fibers. Don't forget your vegetables. Don't forget to really nourish your body with a rainbow of color. And that's really essential as well. It would help to make you feel like you've eaten enough. So the satiety comes into play. It would help you to digest faster. It would help to get the motion in your digestive tract. And that's really important. Keep an eye on not having too much processed food with saturated fat, sodium, but also keeping an eye on your saturated fat intake as well, which is, it's okay to have some, but just in a really good, reasonable amount. And really important to just keeping an eye on the way you're cooking your vegetables, gently steam, not too overcooked, so you keep the nutrients, you keep the vitamins into the greens of your vegetables. And that's so important because it contains so many nutrients and vitamins for you, which you use a lot when you're running and when you're training, right, Ben?
The common problem I see among hard training athletes is that they don't eat enough to fuel their recovery. This obviously slows their recovery and exposes them to other issues. Can you talk about how athletes can determine how much they need to eat?
Yes, that's a really good question, Ben. And, you know, it's tricky because often our athletes are really conscious of their time. They are training and quick, they need to get back to work. And often that's where the window is really important for them to eat. So I always really recommend to take really good care of eating around your session. That's really, really important because that's where you're going to maximize the window of opportunity for you to be able to consume food there. That will help as well to manage better your goal. Option one, you can count your calories. You can count your calories if you do have time and if you are able to understand how much you're supposed to have. But the fueling around the session is also, it's also really, really important, to be able to nourish your body with the macros that you need, with your protein, with your carb and your recovery. And especially for athletes that do have two sessions a day, that's really, really key to do that.
Yeah. I'm a believer as well in, carb cycling and matching food intake to output. Obviously on days where it's a rest day and you're not training very hard, there's not much energy expenditure. So obviously your requirement for food and specifically carbohydrates is lower on days like that. Whereas when you've got your long run, there's a huge energy demand. And yeah, obviously you need to fuel that so that the output during that session is really good, but you recover quickly afterwards to get back into future sessions. Do you have any thoughts on carb cycling at all?
Yeah, it could be really useful for a lot of athletes, depending on if their training is quite different from one day to the other, and especially if they are training 2 or 3 days a week, their demand will be higher on the days of their training and their long rides. So that's quite important as well to do that at that moment. But it needs to be something that is manageable for the athlete as well. And for a lot of them, perhaps it needs to be done in supervision with someone that really helps them how to implement that and how to manage that. And you need to be consistent as well in your training, right? Because that's really important, because if you don't match your training with your food, you're planning a big session, but you're pushing it, but then you haven't adjusted the nutrition around that on the day before a long session, that's going to be tricky as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You need energy to fuel the output.
Yeah,
right?
It's really important.
You know, it's easy to get caught in the trap of like, I need to be as light as possible and lean. And that's true. You don't want to carry any unnecessary kilos. One of the fastest ways to get faster is to lose excess body fat. But there's a limit to that. And you have to do this in a way that is healthy and in a way that is going to give you long-time benefits. Like for most of us, this is a hobby. You know, we're not professional athletes. And so we need to eat in a way that fuels our body, nourishes our body, and allows us to be consistent. Because as Corral mentioned, yeah, consistency is the ultimate performance enhancer.
So yes, Ben, in regards to weight loss, that's a really excellent point. I just wanted to highlight that point as well, because just really a message to come across is to really pay attention to not mixing too many goals at the same time. And I often see that in my clinic. Is I would have an athlete that calls me and say, hey, Corral, can you help me? I've got a marathon in 3 months, but I need to lose 5 kilo. And this is not the good time to do it because it means that you will have an impact, a negative impact on your training and your energy level. So it's really important to time your weight loss goal at a different moment than your race goal. And I know it feels like it's really important to lose the weight for a marathon, 100% agree. But there will be better time in the year to add that. And having a seasonal training is really helpful for that, because you can help in doing the weight loss when you're on the off season, working with a nutritionist or doing the challenge with coach or etc. And then you can really help to have the fitness level and the weight loss when you are ramping up for your marathon goal. And that's key to be able to manage your energy level.
Weight loss is often a byproduct, though, of training. So even if you're not focusing on weight loss specifically from a nutritional point of view, I think you can still potentially lose some weight, hopefully through just aerobic training and your fat metabolism improving. But I agree, like when output is high, you need to match that output with fuel. Otherwise, training will suffer and you might find your body starts to break down. So don't be scared to eat enough, but just ensure you're eating high quality, nutritious foods and not living on ultra processed junk food. And if you do that, you should be good.
Yeah.
All right. When it comes to training and race fueling, you're trying to achieve two things. The first is you need energy to fuel your effort, as we've just spoken about. And two, you need to hydrate to replace the volume of sweat that you're sweating out in buckets in Singapore and the electrolytes you lose within that sweat. How do you recommend that runners address both of these areas, Corral?
Yeah, so it's really, really good point. So dissociated the two elements of your needs in terms of the nutrition and the hydration is key. Determine where your factors environment are. Also understanding the type of race you're going to have access to. Where is your race? How is going to be the climate there? Is an element that you need to have to factor in. So when it comes down to your training, understand the hydration, understand your needs, how you coping with the climate and your sweat, and then hydrate accordingly, right? So you need to have the right amount of, you do your sweat test or you do your sweat rate, and then you have the right amount of hydration in terms of compensating for that, right? It doesn't necessarily need, you don't necessarily need to have 3 liters of water on the days you're running. It just is the right adaptation and calculation for your electrolyte and sodium replacement. And that's the first element, right? Secondly, it will be your nutrition. So build up slowly. And I often see people on a training plan for a marathon, and they will be like, oh no, I've got plenty of times. I don't take anything now. I'll do that when I'm on the long runs a few weeks before a race. What's really the success of your fueling and hydration during a race lays on how you're planning before that. So we recommend usually 6 to 8 weeks minimum to get started with your nutrition and your hydration. So we slowly, the way I work in my clinic with clients, we slowly build up to your pattern and how your training plan is. You telling me, okay, I do this amount, and then we'll tweak that and slowly build up to a goal where you're going to know exactly how many carbohydrates, when you're taking them, and also your hydration. And this is important. The earlier we start on this, the better and the higher chance of success we know, because things go out of the way sometimes, and you will be able to replicate so many times your plan, your nutrition plan, to then help you feed into your race strategy. And that race strategy can only be successful and spot on for you if we really work towards those steps prior to that. And that's really, really important. It gives you the time to try different brands, different type of gel, different way of, it could not be gel, perhaps you want to take some chews or anything else. But if you wake up 2 weeks before a marathon and listen to someone who says, oh, I do that, then there is a higher chance of that plan not working out for you. So you spend months training for a race. It's really important to invest in the time to be able to put that plan and strategy plan to your needs and how it works for you.
Absolutely. And guys, so you know, nutrition is more important the longer the distance that you're racing. You know, if you're just doing the 5K, you're quite lucky you have enough stored glycogen to see you through the event. Yeah. Even for the 10K, that's probably the case. But when you get to the half and to the full marathon, there's a huge energy requirement, and you are going to need to take in external sources of energy. So as Corral mentioned, the best ways to do that are usually gels, just from a practicality point of view. But mm-hmm. you can use chews, you can use gummies. You can eat real food if you really want to, although that's not recommended, but you will need energy. All right, and let's talk about hydration. So when I think about hydration, I'm thinking about it in terms of volume of sweat that's coming out of the body, and within that, electrolytes, and specifically sodium. When you race, you need to be replacing both the volume you're losing and the sodium that's coming out with it. Now, obviously, you don't need to do a one for one. You don't need to replace everything you lose.
And you can't.
But you certainly need to limit your losses so that you can maintain a higher performance. How would you recommend people hydrate during the race?
So that's a really good point. And you're absolutely right. You cannot replace all the volume you're losing, because it's not doable. And sometimes we lose 2 or 3 liters and you can't do that. So by doing this plan ahead of time, you will be able to understand how much you are losing. And usually in performance, we are trying to minimize the loss of a fluid, because we know that over 2 or 3% of loss of fluid, it impairs your performance. So the goal is to adjust and tweak that hydration plan the same way as we would do it with the nutrition, to really make sure that works, that shoes fits your feet. So your volume of fluid, of loss of fluid, is actually really compensated, and you feel that your performance are not impacted. You are still able to do your intervals during your long run, or you are still able to perform the way you want with your race target. And that's really important. So we work this way. So different ways to carry the water and different ways to take the fluid at different time as well.
So if you were going to run a marathon, how would you approach this? Like, what would you take?
So you could take, depending on the marathon, there's marathon where it's a lot accessible to have, you can access the tables easier than others. The standard charter, there's a lot of people, and I know that it's quite difficult sometimes to have access to the table. In Europe, there is ways for people to be able to race smaller races as well. So depending on the race, that also is important. A lot of the athletes that I work with, they train with a flask. And that is great. That works really well because it's small and they sometimes have pockets, but that's something we discovered together. You would try different things. There's some really good belt where you can put your flask in so you don't have to carry the flask and you can replenish the flask at the table, and et cetera. But carrying your hydration with you and not relying on what you have on the race is also important. Knowing what you have on the race is more important because if you lose something or if you don't have it, you know what they have. And nowadays, some races have really good hydration product and they are easy to access and for you to test. And that's also a really important point to have.
So for me, I like to keep things simple. I'll essentially do a preload of sodium the night before,
Oh, yeah.
1500 milligrams, or 750 milligrams and 500 mils. I'll do that again the morning of the race. Then throughout the race, because I just like to keep things simple, and fortunately I'm still fast enough that I'm at the pointer end of fields and the congestion is not such a hassle. I use the water at the aid stations to address the volume I'm losing. And then I take the sodium pills within the race to address the sodium loss that's going. And as I'm doing that, I'm on a religious cadence of gels so that I'm replacing the energy that I lose. And again, everyone's stomach tolerance is different, their fat burning is different, the speed at which they're running the race is different. And so the frequency of the gels will differ between people. And that's what Corral is talking about in relation to testing this in training to find out how much energy you need.
That's right. And the preloading is important. I didn't mention that. Obviously, I was thinking in the purpose of the race, but the preloading is really key.
So we've just mentioned gels and chews as an option during the race for energy. They're technically forms of supplements, but Corral, I'm interested to hear your thought on the more traditional version of supplements, like the vitamin supplements and things that athletes can use to get some of the vitamins and minerals they need. What are your thoughts on supplements? Should athletes be using them? If so, how?
Important supplements that you can use and I would often recommend is magnesium. We lose a lot of magnesium throughout sweating and with stress, and we work on top of being an athlete. So you go through stress every day, and magnesium get pumped really rapidly with the stress and the sweat and excessive exercise, which is really important to replenish in terms of the muscle function and also for your sleep. To really help and promote your deep sleep. So magnesium is a good form, is a good supplement. There's different form and depending on your needs, you can adjust the type of forms. With, I often see athletes looking for supplements that would make, help them. What should I take? So there is lots of supplements out there, which you can discuss with a professional, the creatine, there's a lot of those type of supplements. But more generally, when we come to nutrient, I would say make sure you do a regular blood test to check your levels of iron, all your minerals that you could more likely deplete, and that would have an impact on your performance. Rather than trying to cut the edge, is trying to make sure you understand what is there that you are maybe lacking already. And understand that with your GP, you do a blood test and you understand your levels. And that's great because we can help you as professional. We can help you to really work on those deficiencies. And that would make a difference in terms of your performance as well. But, and also another thing I see often in the clinic is athletes taking different kinds of supplements because they are they heard from a friend, oh, this is great, this is great, this is great. Now, what's really important is some of those supplements can actually, in the long term, be in opposition with each other. They can have a conflict, or they could just simply not do anything for you. So find out as well. Don't hesitate to maybe not take them for long term, or find out with a professional what is the best approach for you.
I think there's a couple of good points there. Like, one, you should never copy anyone else.
No.
Context matters a lot. And that's true for training, it's true for nutrition and supplementation as well. Like, why one athlete is doing something and why you should do it could be completely different. And I think understanding the why is very important so that you can do this in a way that's safe and going to give you your best output. The other thing you mentioned was around blood testing. Like I'm also a very strong proponent of blood testing at least once a year to sort of get a sense of how your body is going. A lot of athletes spend a lot of money on the latest gear. And I think a lot of the time it would be far better invested into something like blood testing or working with you, Corral, or doing coaching, because these are the things that are truly, truly going to move your performance forward. And I encourage all athletes to invest their money and time wisely to try and get their best output, but do it in a way that is safe for now and going to give you long-term health and benefits into the future. Thanks for tuning in, folks. If you'd like help with your nutrition, be sure to check out Corral at www.corrallorentnutrition.com. If you need help with your training, I'd love to work with you. Check out www.coach.fitness and sign up for a free trial where we will set up a training plan for SESM and get on a Zoom call to discuss your goals. Please follow coach.fitness and SG Marathon on Instagram. We're going to be posting a weekly reel to further enhance your preparation. Join us for our next episode where we're going to be talking about injury prevention and management, something very important for runners because it is a very high impact sport with a high injury rate. That's all for today. See you in the next one.